All the distinguished panelists on the dais, Sani ji, Dr. Train, to whom Shekhawatji, late Shekhawatji, sent Rajiv Maharshi, now the finance secretary, and me in 95 to open a hospital in Rajasthan. Tarani ji, I am Banerjee. I have been told that I should only talk of the way ahead, and that is a surgical kind of diagnosis, but I would like to say, at the risk of offending Dr. Train, not offending, just making a point, that surgeons get preceded by the physicians. So whereas a whole lot of things are known to all of us, I think some still need to be known, and this is a syncretic process which will go hand in hand. First, the good news, including the good news about medical council. Dr. Train sir, your medical council has so far cleared till 28th February 27 qualification packs and 417 national occupation standards. In all, the sector skill councils handheld by NSDC, I think the CEO is also here, have done 1077 qualification packs and 5563 national occupational standards. And this has been done by 25 functioning sector skill councils. There are 31 in all. The rest are in the process of being established. And these councils were initially kind of done the, as I said, the hand-holding, and not just hand-holding in emotive terms, in financial terms also was done by the NSDC. I joined as the first secretary of this ministry on 2nd September. And sir, not only next year, we will tell you what we are trying to do right now, after about 4 to 5 months of our existence, and how we are succeeding and how we need to go ahead. As far as the issues are concerned, very broadly, I would classify them as the following. A lot was said about 2%. We keep on hearing 2% Indian workers are trained or skilled. With all due regards, whereas I agree with all other observations made here, this 2% is a bit of a misleading figure, because a whole lot of weavers of Varanasi, of Kanchipuram, the gold and jewelry workers in Jaipur, in Surat, so on and so forth, in hundreds of places in this country, they are skilled. They are not qualified. They have been doing this job generation to generation. So the fault lies somewhere with all of us, whether it is industry or the government or the academia, that despite being so highly skilled, they are still not, in the technical sense, qualified. There comes the issue of RPL, recognition of prior learning. They need to be kind of certified. A way out has to be found, that a certification is done on the basis of their skilling. And I am glad to report to you that in the Pradhan Mantri Kaushal Vikas Yojana, approved by the cabinet about 12 days back, in the star, 10 lakh people had been covered. Now 24 lakh people would be covered. Bit of scaling up. Maybe more scaling up is required. Rather, far more scaling up is required. But out of that, 10 lakh would be exclusively for RPL. That is those who are skilled but not certified. Issue number two, certification itself. There was a notification issued, as has been mentioned, in December 2013, called National Skill Qualification Framework. That makes it mandatory for various certifications to align to NSQF within 3 to 5 years, even going to the extent of saying that if after 5 years it's not aligned to NSQF, further funding for various schemes would be stopped. Mr. Ramadurai, he doesn't need an introduction. He is the chairman of National Skill Qualification Framework, and we are all working together. As secretary, I am also a member. We are all working together to ensure that all the meticulous work done by the sector skill councils gets formally aligned to NSQF or is recognized as such. And I'm sure in the next 1 year, if at all I'm again asked to stand here, we'll be able to report that it has been done. A large part of it has been done. Third issue, why are we producing as a system degree holding illiterates from Mofussil colleges? Why are we not going for vocational education in our vocational subjects, at least in a big manner? As Dr. Tain said, some states have started moving towards that. One of the best islands in this regard probably initially was in North Haryana, but they have done it 400 institutes. They have 23,000 schools. So that's the kind of scaling which is required all over the country. In Gujarat, in Haryana, in Maharashtra, in many states this has been done, but on a pilot basis. I think after so many years of independence and with the kind of demographic dividend we keep talking about, which is all correct also, but as I said that it could be demographic disaster or revolution making, we now need to scale up very speedily while ensuring quality outcomes and vocational education may not be panacea of all ills, but it will offer career options to the kids, that rather than going in all over Europe and USA, the number of kids who go to the university or college systems, as we are knowing, is much less than those who kind of start something after 12th of this thing. Number three, why not make skill aspirational? Honorable Prime Minister in one of the review meetings said, why should we not have convocations for ITI students? Why only having these degree colleges? That was just a way of saying that skills have to be made aspirational. Make in India, references are made to Make in India. We can have people, we can skill people. Where are the jobs? This ministry, only part of it is entrepreneurship. That part will help create some jobs, provided the issues of microcredit, credit, other issues of ease of doing business, which are to be resolved and which are being resolved at other fora, are resolved. But at the same time, it is here that all of you, captains of industry, employers, have to play a major role. In terms of, you will say that I'll create jobs to the extent the economy demands it. It's a very complex question, doesn't have a one-line answer, just as most complex questions do not have. But yes, jobs are required. Only then the skilled people, otherwise just as the degree holding illiterates are not getting jobs, then skilled people will not get jobs. Convergence between intra-government, inter-government, and between, one is the convergence at the intra-government level. 21 ministries, departments are doing skilling programs worth about 7,000 crores. These are the, because there is no separate skilling head, so these are the figures gleaned from their programs. The total spend roughly of the corporate sector at the moment is between 3,500 to 4,000 crores. This is where we stand. And if we have to scale it up, say minimum to up to even 8 to 10 million a year, I don't kind of have to spell out what kind of funds we need. Those funds neither corporates alone can provide, nor trainers can provide, nor government can provide. Some kind of our solutions have to be worked out together. And also, when people, CSR alone would not do, CSR is doing so many things. So maybe some kinds of thoughts have to be given to whether there has to be a skill set or something, but those are things to be decided at the policy domain. And when it comes to convergence between whom? Convergence between the industry, between the academia, and between the entire skilling ecosystem is a need of the day. It was always a need, is more of a need today. I can tell you that when I took over, I was the only one. In 3-4 months, we tried to create some small structure. We have a full ministry now. I had two options. One was to keep sulking about the fact that you have to create a structure, and one was to kind of start interacting with people. After having interacted with more than maybe 180 or 200 stakeholders in 4 or 5 months throughout our country, and after having remained secretary industries in Rajasthan for 3 or 4 years, especially in those 4 months, I think one feels humbled. There are so many islands of excellence. In North alone, in our NCR in Rajasthan, we have skilling examples by a lot of corporates. We have JCB doing their job, we have Hondas doing it, we have Genpec doing it, Bosch and Lomb doing an excellent job. I mean, I may be missing out hundreds of names after taking 4, 5, 10, but a lot of people are involved in skilling. Similarly, there are professionals. I know of professionals who have left extremely lucrative jobs in investment banks to work in places like Northeast and Bhubaneswar. I know of people who have left teaching jobs in Australia. In fact, one MOU is tomorrow to now work in the Naxal-affected districts of the country. The need, as I said earlier, is to scale it up, because islands of excellence alone shall not do. Dr. Train said, what is government doing? Yes, A, government has already approved in the cabinet this Pradhan Mantri Kaushal Vikas Yojana, which will be much more scaling up than the star one, and which will also include RPL. B, our plan funds have formally started from 1st April 2015, which is 5 days back, and obviously whatever plan funds are available to us, and we have been told that as we spend, we'll get more and more. We will kind of try to kind of assist our this thing. One point I earlier forgot, I mean I would like to mention now, is ITIs. We have more than 11,000 ITIs, around 7,500 to 7,800 in private space, around 2,800 to 2,900 with government. Why are the ITIs, the syllabi, so rigid? That anomaly is being rectified, but in two ways. A, 2,500 new ITIs in the PPP route, for which this ministry has been asked to work out the details. And we are thinking of, we are mentally weighing options of, for example, German dual technology, where the, and some talks are going on with China also in the run-up to PM's visit to China and other countries, to see whether there can be a healthy interchange between the academia, the ITI, and going back to the manufacturing unit. There was a reluctance on the part of employers in the context of rigidity in the Apprenticeship Act. Some of the rigidities have already been taken care of in the last amendments. If there are more, we'll interact with the organizations more and try to ask Ministry of Labour, request them to see that those rigidities are also kind of taken care of, so that the employers, the industry, is not reluctant to take on apprentices, and we can have a dual learning thing on the ground. There was a skill policy in 2009. It was mandated to be revised 5 years later. That is being now revised, the only change being that now it is national skill and entrepreneurship policy 2015, which means allowance will be made for the entrepreneurship part of this. I think a lot more needs to be said by everybody. There will be some questions also. We are all running late in the session. As I say that, this is a very difficult space. We have to think, all of us, I mean, in my humble opinion, not as CII, not only as civil servants, not just as entrepreneurs, but as citizens of India, that in 2020, in my opinion, in 2015, 16 or 16, 17, if Skill India and Make in India do not become two sides of the coin, we will probably be losing our act. So I don't think we have till 2020 to wait for that in that sense. And finally, the poet says, Hawadis se ulajkar muskurana meri fitrat hai. Hawadis se ulajkar muskurana meri fitrat hai. Mujhe dushwariyon mein ashk barsana nahi aata. So all of us have to kind of try and work like that. Thank you.